this thing. Y'all got a bone spur, heel spur, whatever you call it. But I'm going to suck it up for you guys. You'll never know I'm hurt. I'm doing that just for y'all. Well, we've got a good thing to do today. First, I want to read this for clarification. And Sergeant Trevina, are you? Where are you?
I'm here, sir.
Oh, you're there?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, why don't you just come on up here? You're the man of the hour. And stand up here with me. This letter is to certify that the accompanying Georgia flag was flown over the city of Tifton at City Hall at 204 Northridge Avenue on March 19th of 2014. This flag was flown in recognition of Sergeant Michael Anthony Trevino's continuation to the state of Georgia and greater Tift area. We thank you for your commitment to service and your dedicated work for our community and its citizens, and we wish you great success in all of your future endeavors. We've got a little pin right here. That's actually the key to the city. See that? Now, this is what a real key to the city looks like. I don't know what door it opens. It might open some of those old doors over at the Mine Hotel, because those things are real big old doors. But I'm going to give you this one, the key. This is ceremonial for the newspaper to get a picture of. And I think Jessica will snatch it back away from you. We don't have any of them. But you want to get a picture? But I'm going to let you hold it until she does snatch it. And there's your letter. Here's your flag. Now, he gets to keep flag, right? Now, I don't know if this is up to military standard. I know I was in the Boy Scouts, but if it's wrong, don't beat me up. I can't run. And if you just bear with me, I'd like to read this proclamation. Honoring Sergeant Michael Anthony Trevina for his great service to our community. Whereas Sergeant Michael Anthony Trevina was assigned to duty as a Marine recruiter at the permanent contact station in Tifton, Georgia on May 26, 2011. And whereas Sergeant Trevino has tirelessly performed his duties in a professional manner, serving the city of Tifton and the surrounding areas. And whereas Sergeant Trevino has continuously displayed those qualities of Marines which reinforce and expand on the trust and confidence of the American people and the people of the state of Georgia and the United States of Marines. And whereas Sergeant Trevino has sought and found more than 50 sons and daughters of Georgia to earn the title United States Marine, thereby continuing to shape the future of the United States Marine Corps. And whereas Sergeant Trevino's contributions to the community have served to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, while creating conditions for personal and professional success for those he led. Whereas Sergeant Trevino's professional excellence and achievements as a Marine recruiter have not come without great personal sacrifice. Whereas the city of Tifton is grateful of the leadership and excellence and service shown by Sergeant Trevino to our community. And as a token of our appreciation, we present Sergeant Michael Anthony Trevino with a key to the city. And now, therefore, I, Jamie Cater, on behalf of the Tifton City Council, and by the authority of the same, that honor, safety, health, prayers, and Godspeed be hereby extended to Sergeant Michael Anthony Trevino as he continues to serve our country as United States Marine. In witness whereof, I have hereunto set my hand and caused the seal of the city of Tifton to be affixed this 20th day of March 2014. God bless you, sir.
City of Tifton. I'd like to thank the recruiting staff. I had no idea
when I was walking through the hallway. I assumed there was an award being given to one of my students at Tift County. I was actually panicked that he wasn't here yet. Kind of why I'm out of uniform and running around the city trying to find him. But they didn't tell me, so I appreciate it. It's been my goal since I've got here. And I outlined as big of a plan as I could in order to, serve the community the best I could, because I found that serving the community, I didn't have to recruit anybody. They all came to me. They all came to me for advice, and they all came to me whenever they had idea of their future plans, and their mothers, their fathers came to me before the applicants did, and that to me was working smarter rather than harder, so I just started turning into the community, and it's been my home for the last 3 years. It's definitely left my mark, being a city boy from Los Angeles, California. I definitely learned a great deal about being humbled. And just overall faith, everything, and I really do appreciate it. So, thank you very much. This is a great honor, and I'm not going to forget it.
Thank you, Jordan. I'll buy another one if you don't. I like doing things like that. Let me tell everybody, too, if I give up tonight, it's because I've been sick for about a month. I literally had the flu, and it got complicated because I'm a diabetic. And I'm just now getting back into doing things. So I'm a little shaky. But I'm here, so that did that with me. I wasn't first to get here, but I'm here. The discussion of the health care reform, employees' benefits, Mr. Skip Hill. And did anybody want to preface that, Carla?
I'm going to turn it all over to Skip.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. It's a good hand.
Mayor, sure. Every year, you know, Skip's been handling our health care benefits for quite some time now, and they go out and they shop around to get us this bang for our buck that we can get, and they're coming for us now. There's a couple of things they're going to talk to us about, the Affordable Care Act, implications that may or may not impact our health care program, and how well they're doing and taking care of us, and how little bit they're going to make us go up this year.
All right.
Mayor and City Council, it's good to be with you this afternoon. When the mayor stepped in, he asked me to only try to cover the first 1,000 pages of the 2,000 pages of health care reform. So I will try to give you a 10,000-foot view of health care reform as of 2014. And if you have any specific questions, I'll try to hold comments as it relates specifically to you, the City of Tifton, and the City of Tifton's employees. If you watch TV, if you read the newspaper, obviously you know health care reform is upon us in 2014. There is an individual mandate, obviously, that everybody that is living and breathing must have health insurance by March 31st of 2014, or you will pay a tax penalty assessment, however you want to look at that. That penalty will be to the tune of $95 per year for those that do not have health insurance, or 1% of your household income. So, as an example, if I'm working somewhere and I have health insurance available to me, but my spouse chooses not to take that coverage, and she goes out onto the exchange to try to apply for a subsidy, then obviously what determines her penalty if she doesn't have health insurance will be based on our combined income if we file a joint tax return. She would not be eligible for a subsidy just because the fact that I have health insurance available to me at my employer, even though that coverage either may not be available to her or she may choose not to take that coverage, possibly due to the cost. So the individual mandate's the first thing that takes place in 2014. As far as groups are concerned, there will never be a pre-existing condition clause on any health insurance plan going forward. which means, as you know, in the past, when you went from one employer to the other, as long as you could prove you had credible coverage, you would not have to go through a pre-existing period. However, if I did not maintain coverage for a certain period of time and I went to work for an employer, I still had a pre-existing condition clause for up to 12 months. All pre-existing condition clauses will go away as of a group's renewal date in 2014. So going forward, when the city of Tifton hires an employee, we will not ask have they had coverage prior to that employment or with a previous employer. The city of Tifton will be responsible for covering all conditions as of that person's effective date. So no pre-existing conditions is obviously the second thing that's changing in 2014. The third thing that's changing is, in the past, the city of Tifton has had a first of the month following 90 days of employment before someone becomes eligible for benefits. That rule is changing, and the city of Tifton will be required to offer insurance to employees once they have completed 60 days of employment, first of the month following that, whatever date obviously that may be. We obviously are trying to keep the city of Tifton up to date on the health care reform. Obviously that's a challenge because, as many of you know, it changes on a daily basis. So those are really the specifics as far as how that affects the city of Tifton. One positive change that is taking place as far as your employees are concerned as of the renewal date this year, as many of you know that are covered by health insurance, in the past you had a deductible on your health insurance plan and then you had an out-of-pocket, which is normally met when an employee pays their 20%. However, if you've paid copays in the past, whether that copay was to a physician's office, whether that copay was to an emergency room, whether that copay was to an urgent care center, those copays never went toward my out-of-pocket. Those always were kept separate. Going forward, whether you're covered here at the city or whether you're covered under another plan, all copays or any out-of-pocket that an employee pays going forward must be included in that out-of-pocket maximum. The only exception in 2014 will be prescription copays. And the prescription copays will count toward that out-of-pocket, obviously, in 2015. So there's just a one-year delay on that, which basically means that if I've got an out-of-pocket of $2,000 today, going forward in 2014, I probably will hit that out-of-pocket a little bit quicker because I have more out-of-pocket expenses that will now obviously count toward that out-of-pocket maximum. Okay. The city of Tifton, just again to give you just a brief overview, for this past year, the city of Tifton is currently with Cigna Insurance Company. The city of Tifton had a 130% loss ratio. So I think most people understand loss ratios. That means if we paid in $100,000 to Cigna, Cigna paid out $130,000. With that loss ratio, in addition to some taxes and fees that the insurance carriers are having to pay due to the Affordable Care Act, one of which is what we call a transitional reinsurance fee. That is a fee that is paid to the government that will be dispersed to insurance companies who are covering high-risk individuals who, obviously, pre-existing conditions and everything else will be covered as of today. That tax will be $63 per year per covered person on your plan, which means that if I've got a family of four, then the city of Tifton, through premiums, will pay a tax of $63 for each person in my family for that 12-month period. The increase that was handed down from Cigna, which includes these additional taxes and everything, equates to a 20.79% increase for this coming year. As you know, there is also a mandate coming in 2015 that if you employ more than 100 employees, you must offer health insurance to anyone that works 30 plus hours a week. That is considered full-time, and you are not going to be allowed to charge them more than 9.5% of their W-2 income, whatever, on a per-pay period basis that they're paid. So we made a recommendation to Mr. Reiner and Ms. Cooper that we go ahead and offer a plan, a third option. Presently, your employees have two options as far as health insurance is concerned. One is what we call a copay plan, and one is what we call a higher deductible plan.
We are making a recommendation that we add a third plan that meets the requirements of the Affordable Care Act. It has a much higher deductible. However, it will allow us to offer a plan that will be much more affordable to the employees, actually cheaper than any plan that is being offered today. Just having that as an option. If we didn't offer it this year, it's going to be something that we would have to make available, obviously, in 2015. So we're going ahead and making that plan available for this upcoming open enrollment. Any questions about just reform in general? Any specific questions as it relates to your plan?
You did good. We're the target to you for
exactly. Well, as always, we appreciate the opportunity to work with the city, especially Mr. Reiner and Ms. Cooper. I think it's been a good working relationship, and we look forward to the challenges in the future that health care reform brings.
We appreciate your team.
Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next item is discussion of employee handbook changes. Ms. Carla.
And Skip has gone over most of these for me.
Okay.
So in order to comply with health care reform, there are a few changes that we need to make in our handbook. One is the benefits eligible to employees no more than 90 days. And so what we're proposing, and it is highlighted in yellow in your packets, we are proposing that our handbook say all benefits will be effective the first day of the month following 60 days of full-time employment. The other thing that Skip talked about was the 30-hour a week, and so we are still defining full-time employment as anyone working 40 hours. However, we are changing our part-time employment to say employees who are regularly scheduled to work less than 30 in a week or less than 130 in a month. Those are one other change. There's a paragraph in our handbook that currently talks about the health care plan, and mainly it talks about the city pays 80% of the premium for employees and 50%. We would like to take those specific percentages out and have more of a generic statement. Not that we don't pay. One of our plans, we do only pay 70%. However, the other two plans that we will put in place this year and the one that we already have, we pay more than 90%. And so while it averages more than 80%, we don't specifically pay that specific percentage. And so we want to take the wording out that has any specific numbers in it. And it will just say that the plans are described in separate documents provided by the insurance carrier and made available from Human Resources and on the employee portal. So, any questions about those changes? And again, this is all due to health care reform. These are changes that are mandatory that we make. So, once you approve the changes, we will obviously update our handbook. We will get this on the employee portal. We will send it out to all employees. Plus, we will have it available at the departments for them to post on their bulletin board so that all employees are aware of it.
Any questions?
Blair, I got a question for you. From time to time, you know, when people get out there and start working, you lose track of time, especially if you've got a project and everybody's working together or whatever. Let's say, for instance, on the new, the proposed plan is to call each employee that works in minimum of 40 hours plus is considered full-time. What if you get somebody that's like, and it says half or part-time is 30 hours a week or less. Well, somebody hits that 35 hours a week in between the two, what would, because our current policy says 35 hours or more is considered full-time, 35 hours less is considered part-time. I mean, there's a gap between there now.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Most of our part-time employees are office staff. We don't have any, I can't think of a single part-time employee we have out in the field. So we'll be able to manage that time pretty well. And I think it's 130 hours, if it goes 130 hours a month, go over 1 week and then you just back it down the next week and make it up.
Okay, no more questions. Bob, thank you.
Thank you.
Joe? Next item is the discussion of the James E. Dove Scholarship Awards. Ms. Dove?
This time again, we have received numerous applications for scholarships. It's been a daunting task, so we're in the process of announcing them, going through and reading them now. We've incorporated other people from Municipal Gas Authority and also Mr. Dove's son, Ernest, who comes when we come to present it. So we'd just like to inform the council that it's coming up, and we will ask for this presentation with the parents and the children and for the mayor to present the scholarship award. Should be regular council meeting in May. So, no action required, just want to make sure y'all, you know, that you were informed about it, and we'd like to let you know. And we're excited, there's a lot of them on there. It's hard to pick, so.
Right. No, we thank you for the great job that you did.
How do you go about applying for this scholarship?
It's
through the school system or through?
Well, actually, the guidance officer there at Tifton County High School has been the one that's coordinating these all these years. She sends us out a memo asking us we're still participating. I actually had a call from a parent of a child of Tidaria this year, and of course I said, you know, we don't have any standard forms. We take the local scholarship. There's a lot of them out there. Tifton County is very generous. Their businesses, a lot of them offer scholarships, and so they present to us a scholarship application, a short bio about themselves. A lot of them give references, their SAT scores. Also, have they been applied for and accepted to a college? We go through all those, and they have the applications where they've been accepted to school attached and their SAT scores. They don't put a lot of things on there. They don't put their parents' names as much their occupations. So we try to look at the overall student, the well-rounded, the one that works and helps in the community, the one who would be best served by this scholarship money. Of course, we want them to have it for continuing their education, but we look at the whole package, and it was tough this year. And the years that are tough, I ask for help, and that's what I've done this year. And so we're waiting on Mr. Dove to come and help us get through them. And whenever we kind of all picked, there's two this year. That's what we've done generally in the last few years. And so we've all picked our two, so I guess we'll sort, just kind of put it together and see who comes out, the two that comes on top, because it's really too hard to pick between them all. They're excellent, excellent. Most all of them have either been accepted to Georgia, Georgia Tech, Valdosta, even as far as Kennesaw, some of them. They have a wide range of backgrounds. Some want to be vets, some want to be biologists, some want to be nurses, PAs, so there's a bunch of them. So we look at the whole package and try to do due diligence about the whole process.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Don. Mm-hmm. Next item will be the discussion of bids for a crawler dozer proposal for solid waste. Mr. Ricky Hoff.
You've got a package there before you for a bulldozer at the landfill. There were four proposals sent out, four returned, with two of them meeting specs. This is to replace an existing dozer, which we have on a 5-year buyback plan. It expires this May 2014. And it's to be funded through approved funds of the capital outlay program for the landfill. It also shows you there a 5-year buyback, what they expect to give us back at the end of the 5-year period. Purchasing the dozer. The staff recommends awarding the proposal to Yancey Brothers Company, Valdosta, and this is due to the facts of, I know you all see the picture there, it's a high track system on this Dozier, which is less maintenance, less downtime for Dozers versus a load track, if you will, because of the final drive being in the garbage all the time. So that's one of the issues. The recommendation of our operators, the point of visibility of this particular Dozier, the safety factor, there's better visibility in the cab of the cat. So, and also with our past experience, we've had a cat Dozier on our landfill, I know, for the last 15 years. So we just recommend the Yancey Brothers proposal for $333,181 with a net 5 year of $213,098. Yes, they're equipped with this pressurized cab, dust control.
I've said for years, put somebody in there.
Yes, definitely.
Rick, you may have touched on it. What's maintenance on, what would cost of maintenance on the, is it the Yancey Brothers, is that the Caterpillar, is that the maintenance on it less?
Well, when I say less, what I'm speaking to is the high-track system, because it's out of the garbage. You don't have downtime taking it down and cleaning out around the tracks. And that's the maintenance end of it. Now, of course, maintenance on all of them, you never know for the use of it. That was my concern about the high-track system there. Any other questions?
Mayor, Council, this is under the budgeted amount, too.
Yes, the budget amount is $358,000.
Okay. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Okay, the next item six, discussion of the next Citizens Police Academy. And I see Chief Dowdy stepping up to the podium now. Hey, thank you.
Alan's stepping in for him. He's been on the range all day trying to help get everybody qualified. So he's been out doing that all day, and he went home, said he was tired, but I saw him standing around a lot. But our next academy starts, Citizens Police Academy starts May the 6th, 2014. And this time what we've done is we cut it back to 6 weeks instead of 10 weeks, but we added in 2 Saturdays into it, and that's how we were able to cut it back, because we figured that maybe 10 weeks was long on people. That's an obligation. So we got the same thing in the academy, and we're still doing everything that we've been doing, but by bringing in the 2 Saturdays, we're going to do criminal investigations one Saturday, and that'll give them a chance. And then we're going to do the firearms the other Saturday. So that will make it a little bit. I brought y'all a copy of the application that'll be going out. And we already accepting applications. So, and then the other thing is our intent to get the CHAPS Academy started in September. We wanted to run the Citizens Police Academy first because it's been a while since we've done one. And so we do that, and then in September, we'll get started with the CHAPS Academy and do that.
Okay, any questions? This has been really a great thing, hasn't it?
Yes, it has been.
Every one of them. A lot of enthusiastic people to come to. Appreciate it.
All right, thank you.
Next item is the discussion of the recommended FY24 budget to be in the lowest level.
You have a package before you. That is the budget revision for fiscal year 14. And included in that package, along with the budget resolution, are 2 sections. The first section is the FY2014 proposed budget revision, and this is summarized by fund, and the major changes are footnoted. And this is being presented at a very high level. If you need any additional information, please just let us know. We'll have all the detail available that you might want. The second section reflects the revised FY 2014 capital budget and the capital plan by department, project, and funded sources. So both of those are included in your package. Just to give you a little background of where all this came from, is the city manager and myself have adjusted departmental budgets within the level of approval authorized within the budget resolution. And that was one of our first tasks, is to look at the line items and adjust the budget within our authority. The changes in your packets or packages require council approval in order to maintain a balanced budget and to ensure actual revenues and expenditures do not exceed that budget amount at the end of the fiscal year. The budget revision takes a current look at the projected revenues and expenditures in comparison to the actual activities as of January 2014. It also includes revisions to projected financial activities that have not materialized this year and takes in consideration factors that were in progress at the time the original budget was presented to you. We consider this revision process to be the first step in the preparation of the FY 2015 budget kickoff. Since we have done lots of cleanup and we've looked at it, the department heads have looked at it, we revisited with them, and everybody has really went through it in detail. We are further along with our accounting and our budgeting process, and we believe that this will aid in expediting the FY 2015 budget process. So we will actually turn around and start that process as soon as you give us approval to do that. I will start with a few of the major changes, and like I said, these are at a very high level. And I will start with the general fund. And lots of them are already noted in your book, but I'll just touch on a few of them. On the general fund, we reviewed the revenue and expenditures for general fund and found them to be in line with the original budget estimates. I'll talk a little bit about the revenues that we looked at, the major revenues, and what we found and the expenditures as we get a little bit further on. We are proposing an increase. The only proposal change to the bottom line is an increase for technology equipment for the new police vehicles. And this is to be funded from the restricted technology fees, which are set aside for that purpose. We set aside 5% of those fines and fees for technology purposes for police and municipal court, and that was a policy that was established, I believe, in 2008. Just to mention a few revenue points that were considered, 87% of property taxes billed have been collected as of the 1st of February. We normally run about $100,000 in receivables at the end of the fiscal year, and we anticipate that to be pretty close to that this year. Our insurance premium that we usually receive in October was received, and that is a full year. And a lot of times when you're looking at the revenues, you're looking at a percentage of what has been collected. Some revenues are collected all at one time. Some comes in on a quarterly or monthly basis. Your lost revenues is being collected at around $220,000 to $242,000 monthly, and the current seven-month average is $228,000. The insurance premium that we have not collected, that will be coming in soon, or we anticipate to, or the franchise fees, electrical franchise fees, excuse me, that have not been received, we anticipate to be received shortly in the amount of about $1 million. So we did take that in consideration. When we reviewed the expenditures, originally they were a little below projections for the time frame in January of 2014. Today we looked at them again, and overall the remaining budget is around 32%, which is pretty much in line with what it should be at this time of the year. We normally run about a month behind in recording expenditures on a normal basis and then accrue that extra month at the end of the year. But some expenditures have already been received or have already been recorded for the full year. We did revise the FY 2014 capital improvement program to take in consideration some delays in some capital purchases of 2015 instead of 14. But most of those equipment items were funded with GMA lease pool dollars, and therefore, you know, they were just rolled forward for that purpose as well. The enterprise funds, we have our major adjustments. Some of our major adjustments there was the ESG water and sewer amended contract was approved after the original budget was approved in June of 2013. We are proposing to adjust the budget to accommodate the actual activity and the trends that have taken place on the remaining accounts that are managed by the city. That includes the total contractual obligation with ESG, and we have also included in this budget an anticipated rebate of $473,000 for fiscal year 14. If you remember back in January when we received the rebate, it was primarily for fiscal year 13 and was accrued to 13. So this is what we anticipate, our estimated amount that we anticipate to receive based on that and based on some conversations with the staff with ESG. We also are proposing to pay off the GIPA 2 debt from SPLOST $4. And I'll talk about that a little bit later when I get to the SPLOST funds. But what we're wanting to do is reclassify that GIFA 2 debt payment to transfer to sinking fund for the same amount, those annual payments, reclassify and set those dollars aside into a sinking fund in order to expedite the retirement of GIFA 4 debt. We have three sewer debts, GIFA 2, 3, and 4. And 2 is the smallest. 3 is the next to that, and then 4 is the largest debt payment. And of course, that would be contingent upon sewer revenues and how they come in, and if we have the funds available at that point in time. The GIFA 2 is at a 4.43% interest rate, and it's not a large balance. The balance right now is $274,000. We anticipate a savings of about $12,000 in interest if we can pay it off before 5/1/14 with SPLOST 4 remaining funds.
5/1/14.
Sorry?
Pay it off before 5/1/14?
Yes, sir. The GIFA 4 has a 3% interest rate currently, and there's an estimated savings of $189,000 if approved to be paid off before 1/1/15. And the current balance is $729,000, so we expect the balance to be around $664,000 if we can pay it off at that time. And that's the reason for setting aside those the GIFA 2 payments and transferring those into a sinking fund where we can actually accumulate enough money to pay that debt off. The GIFA 3 is at a 5.05 interest rate, and we are currently looking at refinancing that. Recently received a potential 2.25% interest rate proposal. I'm not sure if we can actually get that low rate or not, but it is a proposal that just came in this week, and we are
to
research that. we are looking into that as we speak. We are proposing to use available hotel motel tax funds for the renovation of the TIFF Theater. Our projected collections are anticipated to be higher than budgeted at approximately 15% by the end of this fiscal year. And that equates to, I believe, about $170,000 approximately. And we did have prior year revenues to cover most of that additional amount. And then we are accumulated additional dollars or collecting more dollars than we are budgeted, that we budgeted for this year. We have also in the enterprise funds, we've looked at all the capital projects for fiscal year 14, and we've worked with the department and Mr. Reiner and myself, and allocated what we feel like is appropriate for FY14 that can be purchased and what can be postponed to 15. And we've revised that program and the related funding sources. Most of those funding sources are restricted funds. You got your SPLOS $4 or $5 and that sort of thing, and your enterprise fund dollars. Under the SPLOS funds, of course, the payoff of the chief of tutor, which I've just mentioned, the capital improvement program revised to utilize remaining SPLOS 4 funds based on the referendum projects with the eligible projects within the referendum. And on the SPLOS 5 program, we've revised the FY14 capital budget to utilize SPLOS 5 funds as collected per the referendum for eligible projects, with emphasis on the telecommunication debt payoff in 15. And we would like for that to be our first priority. All other funds, we have established budget for new funds per state law or grant requirements, and we've established the budget for those funds. We have adjusted the budget based on completed grant projects, and we've revised the for all funds, the FY2014 capital budget and the capital plan and the related funding sources to accommodate that. As I said, I have a book with me, and we can give you more information, more detailed information. We have a book that's the individual capital projects that will show you the costs and explanation that the departments have provided, the funding sources, the recommended funding sources per project, and the total capital plan. We will be sending that back out for a FY15 revision or to that, and hopefully the more we revise that plan, the better the plan will be, and we'll have a better financial picture of where we're going. We also have a detail on the operating side if you have any questions related to that as well. Any questions?
Just a point of clarification. The report that Lois just gave you was as of February 1st or 28th? February 1st, correct?
Which one?
The report you just made. That was revenues and expenditures as of February 1st.
Yes.
Now, we have received the franchise fee check from Georgia Power, so that was not included in the report she just gave you.
Okay.
I'll make sure that was clear.
Right.
Okay.
How much more did you hear? I usually
was
get it.
Was it close to
almost a million?
Huh?
Almost a million.
That's what it was last year.
Well, that's good.
That's
a good thing.
This first year I haven't gotten it. That's why
probably
don't get to see it. You don't get a chance. I wouldn't make my day.
Lois, this looks great, what y'all do. Can you explain really quick the special revenue fund?
The special revenue fund? Well, the special revenue fund are those checking accounts that are maintained at the department level. And we are in the process of bringing them into the finance department and working with the departments to close out those funds. But in order to do so, we needed to go ahead and budget for that, where we could transfer those monies out and account for them.
So you can put those monies into the general fund? Is that where those monies are going to go?
Most of them will be incorporated in the general fund. Most of them are donated contributions that we have to account for, you know, separately, and we're going to merge them with the general fund and account for them and run them through the same process that we run all other disbursements through. And we have talked to the departments on that, and they're working with us in order to get that accomplished.
Those will be assigned funds or restricted funds specifically for whatever the purpose of the donation was. It's not going to be like we just take the money and throw it in the general fund. They will be restricted assets.
Anything else?
Thank you, Lois.
Thank you for your great matching work. Thanks for working with you. We decided to build a fence around Tifton. We're not going to let you leave.
Oh, okay. Not tonight.
Uh-oh, not tonight. We'll let you get it tonight.
Larry, I got a quick question. On the theater,
building renovation, is details of that, is that in the 14 budget?
Yes, if y'all recall, when we took the bid over, we had some issues that needed to be resolved. We invited Burma down to take a look at the building. We have water in the basement, and their recommendation was $200,000+ to repair. Burma is on board. They're going to participate in that repair. But the actual, they recommended stucco the three walls of the building to permanently resolve the moisture issue that's getting into the basement. And that's where that money's budgeted for.
So is that a structural renovation?
It could be. We're actually going to have to excavate around the basement and waterproof the basement. And we have easements we have to obtain from the property owners in order to be able to do that. And hopefully we'll be starting that project in the near future.
Okay. Next item is item number 8, discussion of proposed changes to the historic district design guidelines and signage. Rob Wilmot. And I, by the way, appreciate what you sent all of us on the emails, and I see this is captured here in the book.
Okay.
But, you know, you gave us what the changes were and and then where we had said we wanted to stay or go, so.
Well, just,
it's good.
Just very quickly, as you all know, I sent up to Department of Natural Resources a proposed revision to the HPC manual, and based upon what I sent up there, they sent back this letter back on March 17th concerning their comments and suggestions regarding the draft. What they did, basically, some of it was stylistic. You know, the old book that I have here, as you can see, is in two columns. So they want it in two columns, so I put it in two columns. It seems like most of the things were stylistic, because I did change and reorganize some of the paragraphs where I thought they may be more appropriate. Getting down to, in the letter, they talk about the new subsections on banners, stick signs, and A-frame signs, and also they talk about guidelines for banners. And let me just kind of review that real quick. Their suggestion was that sections 7 and 8 should be combined into subsections for temporary signs. Text for the subsection should incorporate applicable guides for temporary signs, bullet point, and existing HD manual. In the old manual, as y'all may recall, we had a section for temporary signs. And we drafted up the proposed ordinance for the revisions of the HPC guidelines, we were removing that paragraph on temporary signs. They also went in, when they talked about banners, and I'll go back to temporary signs in a minute, but they said so guidelines for banners should include direction regarding appropriate display mounting. Temporary sign guidelines should have number of day limitations, and the guidelines for the A-frame sign sandwich board should include instructions regarding the placement in the sidewalks during and after business hours. We do have, you know, in the guidelines as far as that they can be horizontal or vertical. We also have those guidelines concerning the size. So I think we've done that. But I think that the issue is really what they may be mistaken when they think that the stick signs, sandwich board signs, and banners are a temporary sign. As y'all may recall, back when we adopted the LDC a year and a half ago, one of the things that we wanted to get away from was temporary signage, because it was a nightmare as far as trying to enforce it, and it just wasn't practical. So this, you know, so what we have now, basically in the LDC, is you can have the sign. This is, you know, you can keep it up there all the time you want to. Now, that's what we contemplated when we started talking about the HPC manual, stick signs, banners, and sandwich boards, is that they wouldn't be temporary in nature. They could be there as long as you wanted them to be there. And so that is an issue that appears to be either a misunderstanding as far as what we were proposing
and the DNR. So I've highlighted that in the particular sections where it addresses banners and stick signs and A-frame signs, where I've stated in there that DNR sees these as perhaps should be more categorized as temporary signage, whereas our proposal and my understanding of what council wants is just to have these signs that can, and not have a time limit and not, them not being temporary in nature. The next issue regarding from the DNR had to do with the electronic graphic display signs. And again, as you can see, they do not believe that that type of signage is appropriate for the historic district. They say if they are to be allowed against the advisement with the concern from HPD, this should only be under special circumstances on a case-by-case basis. If approved as a special case size, operational requirements appear reasonable. What we did in the proposal for the revisions to the HPC manual was to require a certificate of appropriateness for this type of sign, and we also gave some guidance as far as what should be looked at in determining whether or not that particular sign should be given a certificate of appropriateness. So I think that from what I was gathering from the letter was that bottom line, they don't think that they are a good idea, but if you are going to allow them, do it on a case-by-case basis based upon what you perceive as special circumstances. And I think from what we attempted to do was to give some consideration of different things that the HBC can consider in determining whether or not to allow a particular sign in a particular area, such as where is it going to be located, where is it from a residential area, those little bullet points that we put down there for the HBC to consider in determining whether or not to give a particular appropriateness. The next item had to do with illumination. It appeared from what I could tell is that they wanted to, the DNR wanted to maintain the first paragraph of the illumination portion of the manual. And I think that basically states, and I think I included that in blue in what I've submitted to you. Basically, it starts out that indirect lighting is only appropriate for the historic district, and then it goes on to talk about neon signs. Then what we are proposing is that although we recognize that indirect lighting is most appropriate for the historic district, other types of illumination can be considered under certain circumstances. So I didn't see that there was a direct conflict between the first paragraph saying that indirect lighting is only appropriate, but coming back down and saying, however, we recognize it is, but under certain circumstances, other type of illumination can be considered. So I don't think that, I think we could include that request without, and still allow different types of illumination on a case-by-case basis. The last thing I believe they were requesting, there is in the HBC manual different, a little diagram of different types of signs, and they wanted that included, and that's no problem. We'll just go ahead and keep that. So that's basically what we got back from DNR, and as you can see, I didn't make any changes much to what we had proposed other than including that one paragraph concerning illumination, because I think that the other comments really have to do with banners and stick signs and A-frame signs as they relate to being a temporary sign. And so I did not make any changes because it was my understanding that we're not looking at those to be temporary, we're rather looking at those to be permanent.
I like the way you incorporated images of our actual town as well, instances, including Wilmont Powell.
How about that? It's pretty advertising.
Right. Anyway, I thought that was done well. Give real instances of the signs being used.
So that's the whole ball of wax. The only other thing that I did see in from DNR, they did talk about the case size on these electronic graphic display signs, which I assume they mean the size of the letters. I didn't know if you all wanted to consider perhaps having some limitation on the actual size of the lettering that may be displayed on electronic graphic display signs.
Yes,
50% of their overall
right.
signage allowed.
And the letters will apply for the size of the sign. So we're not making changes other than the little thing about the illumination.
It's totally up to y'all. I mean, that's my take on what we got back from DNR, and so I added that in, and I don't think that the suggestions regarding temporary signage is applicable because we're not looking to have these signs on a temporary basis. At least that's my understanding.
Now this will, we will vote on this at the regular meeting, then we'll go to the PNC.
What we were thinking about is that based upon what I've given you, as far as what I perceive to be the final draft, you know, with the inclusion of that one paragraph, that we would take this on then to plan and zoning for their review and recommendation, and then once they have have their review and recommendation, then we'll take this back before council for an actual vote.
Oh, that's right.
But we want to make sure that we had pretty much what we wanted before we actually went to plan and zoning.
Okay,
yeah,
right.
A little bit backwards, but
yeah.
We want to be going back and forth.
I agree.
This has to go through normal advertising procedures and everything.
That's all.
Yes.
Rob, what are your thoughts on asking her or asking DNR if we were to allow these electronic graphic design signs against their recommendation? Is there going to be any penalty or is there going to be any consequence for us doing that? Although, if we're going to be given the ability to allow them under certain special circumstances, because I know that they're, I don't know if they're just setting us up, you know, right there saying, yeah, go ahead and do it, and then, you know, all of a sudden there's a possibility we could be certified.
I would certainly can make that inquiry.
Yeah.
My read of it, though, is that.
That may be a. They have to.
It appears to me, Wes, what they're saying is, we don't think you should do it, but if you do it under special circumstances. And that's why I think that. The way we have the proposal drafted is that we're trying to enumerate those circumstances so we make it appropriate enough. But I'll be glad to.
I think it would just be beneficial for us to know before we make, you know, before we vote on this, is to make sure that there's not going to be any consequence if this is a part of our HPC.
I'll be glad to make that inquiry and see if we can get a commitment from
them. Yeah, see what they say. Because I guarantee you they're not going to do it.
Well, that was my thought too, but
yeah.
It never hurts to ask.
Yeah, because I'm already asked the question. I'm already getting the answer. And basically, what they wrote down here.
Okay. Everybody ready to move on? Item number 9 is the I asked for a discussion of the photo session for the new council and recent idea. It's because Julie, you did ask about a different setting. And I'm more traditional, but I got thinking about that thing. Can we do both? Can we do a formal setting? And then as Julie suggested, we do a relaxed setting if everybody wants to do that. Can we do both, is my question.
Sure, we'll do whatever you want to do.
Yeah, that way you can have the traditional thing out there, you can have some other signs around. I mean, that kind of gets us to do both things, Julie's idea and then the traditional. That's all I was thinking. I know you said forget it, but I wasn't going to forget it. I wanted to give you the opportunity.
I guess we need to make sure that both of those happen on the same day so there's not.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Will we be in the same dress for the
my picture is wearing a tie suit because I was feeling it. I mean, I've seen the website, everybody, you know, the traditional format, which I like to. But then, you know, we were able to take pictures, and they looked, they turned out good. I mean, Eric Wish did a great job with being able to come up with locations and formats and how to stand and pose. Meg, I mean,
it doesn't matter, maybe whatever y'all want to do. It was just.
As long as we all know, right there, where it's going to be, and everything, we're all on the same page.
Yeah, we sure can call me. I know you like to leave me out of the picture, but that's okay. All right, item number 10, that's the resolution providing for voting delegates at the 2014 Municipal Gas Authority. You're going to talk about that. That's usually me and you.
Yes, sir. Every year we have the annual gas authority meeting. And council has to nominate or appoint the delegates who are the voting members of the primary and alternate. So ever since you've been on the mayor, you've been the primary voting member, and then I think Mr. Hetzel was an alternate there for a while, and then y'all put me in there in the mix. So as it stands right now, the appointments are you and I. If council wants to appoint someone else, that's certainly your prerogative, but we need to get the appointment made and the resolution signed and mailed in so that we can have that in time for the annual meeting.
When is the annual meeting? Is May or June?
Remember, Donna?
Sorry?
When's the meeting? The gas party?
It's in May, I believe.
Yeah, May.
But we need to get this resolution to them before May.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry.
I have no objections.
Okay.
I'm fine. That's what y'all been doing.
May 2nd.
Thank you. Okay. So if that's the way we need to move forward, that's what we'll do. We'll have a resolution on the meeting on the 7th of April for your approval. Okay. And then we got to talk about purchasing gas. As y'all know, we get our gas from Albany, from the pipeline that comes from Albany through Tifton, and it goes up towards Douglas. We contract for a certain amount of gas every year. It's about $1 million a year, I believe, is what we've been running. That we contract and we agree that we'll purchase that amount of gas annually. And these contracts come up for renewal about every 6 years. So what you have before you tonight is a contract, for the renewal of the purchase of that gas at wholesale. And the way they do that is they issue bonds. And this bond issue is about $1.1 million, not to exceed $1.5 million. And as we billion, excuse me, that was a Freudian slip there.
Yeah.
It's a B, not an M. But that cost and that obligation is shared across all the members of MGAG. Ours is what, 1.2% West? I think that would be our obligation if everything just went sour and we had to come up with some money. It'd be 1.2% of that. Hasn't happened in the past. We had a November of 2002 contract. It was renewed again in 2008. And as you can see, about every 6 years, contracts come up for renewal and we issue bonds and we buy gas wholesale, and that's how they get the commitment. And that's what that is all about. I would like to have some representatives from MGAG come down for the April 7th meeting and go into more detail about that with you guys and for the public, because when you start talking about $1.1 billion, even 1.2% of that's a pretty huge obligation. Any questions?
That is retired by the revenues from all the MGAG people.
Right. Yeah.
And there never has been an excess obligation. So it would be, I can't imagine there ever would be.
I'm sure that there's a slight possibility. I mean,
it's kind of like a revolving fund almost.
Right.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Any more questions? Thank you.
Thank you, Larry. Ms. Rona, we have discussions of alcohol beverage license for Sonia's Place, located at 116 Poplar Street, formerly known as Lil's Bar.
Yes, sir. Sonia's Place used to be Lil's Bar. Been recently purchased. I've done background checks on the new owner, and everything came back fine, so staff is recommending approval of that one. Item number 13 is for El Matate Mexican Restaurant, where the current El Cazador's is located. Of course, that's new ownership. Background checks came back fine on those folks as well. So staff's recommending approval. El Matate is about $4,000. Little Spar is about $500. So we recommend approval for both of those.
I have a question. When we did those background checks, and when things come up, how does that impact their, does that not impact their ability to?
Alcohol-related offenses?
Yeah.
It does from 5 years, unless it's very excessive.
Okay.
We don't look at anything beyond 5 years.
Okay.
I know one of them did have a DUI, but it was in 1990.
Yeah.
Right.
When they were probably young and dumb, like all of us.
That's good. I had the same question. I saw that.
Number 14, just very quickly, board report. There haven't been any changes since the last meeting, except to say that we do have some interest in the Keep This Beautiful board. Someone asked us to send them an application, so we have. And this evening, if the mayor's prepared, I would like to ask him to appoint the folks to the Tifton Housing Authority, just for it to go on the record, unless you are not ready to do that.
Jim Lever. Taking Vera's place. Now, I kind of left it up to Sharon because the Bridget Roberts, that is an appointment by the people that live there. And I felt like I gave her the authority to go ahead and make that appointment.
Yes. And she's recommending appointment of Chevron Miller. There is an application in your packet.
Yeah. I knew she said she had somebody.
Yes.
And talking about Vera Shaw, I had the opportunity to talk to her at the convention. Doesn't want to serve on another board, so if Joseph LaForest decides he doesn't want to be on the tree board, which I sure would hate that either,
okay.
Ms. Shaw certainly would like to step in. She's a hard worker, and put Jim in there because of his experience, you know, with construction. We're doing so much construction now, and we're just getting eaten up with prices and stuff, so we needed some type of guideline, and Holman was fine with it.
And I believe you wanted to continue to have Arthur Pettiford.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I will send letters out to these folks that let them know that you appoint.
Okay.
Has there been, I know the tree board was looking at sort of reformatting themselves.
They
has
are.
That have
not
done?
Heard anything back. Have you heard from Daniel Clayman?
Yeah. Are they still meeting once a month, or are they not?
They're meeting on an as-needed basis. Well, that's what they intend to do, is meet on as-needed. They're supposed to meet monthly, but they're meeting about every 2 or 3 months or so. That's why they want to take a new look at it. And that's all that I have.
You know, if anybody knows Joe, of course I know Joe, but he has been such an asset on that tree board. He's got that background, and he cares, he stays involved. He would hate to lose him.
I think he wants to stay, but he would like to see something different. They have some thoughts on how to possibly better operate that board.
Right. Now I'm going to do something the lawyer probably going to have a fit about. Let's see. I'm not going to bring up something that's not on here. I'm going to bring up something the legislature's talking about. Can I do that? Thank you. I thought I could. There was an email sent out about, I think, Larry the other day, saying we need to contact our legislators. Can I keep going? And this is about citizens being able to bring a weapon into the, shouldn't say weapon, a firearm into a city meeting. In other words, like a meeting right now, like our building. And, you know, I'm concerned about the city council meetings and workshops, but I'm also concerned about planning and zoning. I was on the planning and zoning for 6 years, and I know it can get pretty hot in there when you start talking about, you know, some zoning issues and things. And if they can bring them here, they can bring them there as well. And I just, I did my little thing with all our folks way back first part of the year. I knew this was coming up. I just asked them to use good judgment. About the point where I'm going to call them all and say, do you want to bring guns into the gallery when
City Hall, everywhere. I meant to mention that, I'm sorry.
And tomorrow is the last day.
So I just, you know, gosh, y'all, in this day, now I believe in freedom of speech. I believe in being able to tote your weapons and everything else. I'm a firm believer. But there's just some places I don't think you need to bang them, because sometimes tempers get hot, people disagree. But I'll say this, and you can write this down, and Mr. Lawyer, you tell me what I think. If they do pass it, I will have a 500 magnum strapped to myself right up here on the thing, because the last person that got killed was in Texas, and they came and shot the mayor first. And he had voted the way the nut wanted him to vote. But he shot the mayor to make a point. So I'm going to wear my bulletproof vest, and I'm going to bring my 500 gallon. Y'all can mark it down. But I think it's the craziest thing. If any of us, if anybody in the audience can have any influence, please, please ask your elected officials to reconsider. Not, and maybe I'm the only one up here that feels this way. But I just think it's a scary thing. Well, I'm a big target, of course. I've got to pay. Thank you for letting me speak on that. That's all. I guess the meeting's over. And we stand adjourned until, what, Larry?